today I will be giving you top 10 tests that you should take at your doctor's office to measure your Hashimoto, to measure your thyroid levels, as well as on that list of the top 10 tests, there is two tests on there that is also beneficial to people with Graves' disease. So for those that have Graves' disease, this video may just be for you, okay? So stay tuned because this video is about to start right now. Showing you that there is life after Hashimoto. For those that don't know me, you can follow me on Instagram at LadyDream890. And also, if you ain't part of the Lady Dream team yet, what is you doing? You need to hit that subscribe button, honey. Lord knows you do, and you know you want these gems, and you know you want to find out the tea about how to attack your Hashimoto, honey, and get your life back and put yourself in remission. And for those that have Graves' disease, this video may just be for you too, because on that top 10 test that I am about to tell you about today, two of the tests that are on that list benefits people with Graves' disease, and they do need to take this test. Before I get into going on sidebars, let's get to this video. The first test that you need to take for measuring your thyroid levels, if anything, just generally testing your thyroid levels, you need to test your TSH. If you have not done so, I don't know what you guys are doing, and I don't know how y'all guys are gonna expect to get better if you guys don't test your TSH. Your TSH is important. So for those that don't know what TSH is, your TSH is a thyroid stimulating hormone test that is used as a screening test for thyroid disease. It can also be used to test for monitoring the correct dose of medication needed for an individual. So, say for instance, if you guys don't know if you have Hashimoto's yet, or you kind of suspect that you do, or if you guys are suspecting that you're hypothyroid, hyperthyroid, the first thing you need to do is get a TSH test. That is the main thing that all doctors test you for. And you don't want to walk out of an office feeling defeated if your doctor has not given you that test. So that's one of the tests you do need to take. And this is how often you should take this test now. You should test every 4 to 6 weeks when starting new medications. So if you guys are just figuring out now that you guys have Hashimoto's, or if you guys are hypo or hyperthyroid, if you guys have Graves' disease or what have you, you need to take this test every 4 to 6 weeks, okay? When you're starting a new medication. The reason why I say that is because if you test every 4 to 6 weeks, it's gonna help measure your medication as far as milligram wise, and whether or not if you should up the dose or decrease the dose due to how your hormones are. You need to know that. If you don't, you will never know nothing, and you will never know whether if you need to increase your medication or go down on it. And to be honest with you, you will know if you need to increase or decrease your medication if you guys are feeling dizzy, or if you guys are taking this new medication for a while and you guys are feeling like as if your thyroid levels are high and you have the symptoms of high hormones, then you need to go back to your doctor and test your TSH again. That is what your TSH test is for, to monitor your medication. Then, once you are well on your way with your medication, you do need to test every 6 months to see if your symptoms are stable. So, that's your TSH test. That's the one test that you do need to take. Another test that you need to take is your free T3 and your free T4. These two tests, I will say, go together. Because of the simple fact that they go together is why you should take this test, okay? So I'm gonna tell you why you should take it based off what it is. So your free T3 and your free T4, they are the two main thyroid hormones. Your T4 is known as the prohormone and is 300% less biological active than T3. So your T3 is the main biological active thyroid hormone and gives us our beautiful hair, replenishes our energy, and runs our metabolism, okay? Your T3 is the most important thing when it comes to your metabolism. And not only that, but if you're getting hair shedding and you're getting dry skin and all those other things, your T3 actually tells why. okay? Your T3 is the reason why we got this beautiful, beautiful silky hair and beautiful, beautiful silky skin and everything else we love about ourselves, okay? And when you don't go to a doctor and you don't test your free T3 and your free T4 and you're having symptoms, honey, you need that. You need that to know how to treat yourself, how to get your hair back, how to get your skin back on track. You get what I'm saying? You really need those things. If you don't, I don't know what to tell you, okay? So here are the factors that inhibit. And what I mean by inhibit, I mean this is what the factors that kind of, I want to say kind of interfere with your T4 conversion to T3, okay? So aging, alcohol, chemotherapy, cigarettes, diabetes, fasting, growth hormone deficiency. So if you guys are having a growth hormone deficiency, you need to get your free T3 and free T4 tested. Heavy metals can interfere with it. Excess iodine, so if you're getting too much iodine, it can convert your T4 and your T3, okay? Also, kidney and liver disease. If you have kidney and liver disease, most likely you need to test your free T3 and your free T4 because it will interfere with your hormones, all right? So also, low progesterone, medications can interfere with it, so you guys need to check the side effects for certain medications that you do take, all right? Be strongly careful and always, always ask your provider what the side effects are to certain medications. I mean, come on, we all seen those commercials where they're like, if you guys have kidney disease or liver disease, please don't take this medication. Those type of commercials, okay? And that's just an example. I mean, they don't say that, but it's just an example to what it is. If you guys have nutrient depletions, if you suffer from obesity, then you do need to check your free T3 and your free T4 because most likely, if you're starting to gain weight and you're becoming on the obese side, then that's something that you do need to look into if you're looking to lose weight and you're wondering why you're gaining weight so much. Pesticides can also interfere with that. So if you're on pesticides, honey, you need your free T3 and your free T4 testing. Radiation can do that. Soy, surgery, and stress, okay? I cannot stress that enough, all right? I have a soy intolerance. And one of the things that I will say that you need to get a test for that I was going to mention in the next video, but seeing how it kind of ties into that and they did touch base on soy in this, I will say this. You do need a food intolerance test. And what I mean by that, please, please, for the love of God, please, do not let no doctor tell you that a food allergy test is the same thing as a food intolerance test, honey. No, it's not. Do not let someone at a doctor's office tell you that a food intolerance test is the same as a food allergy test. When I went to my immunologist and I asked for a food intolerance test, this was his response. Miss Bailey, a food allergy test is the same as a food intolerance test, so we're not going to give you the test. You want to know what my expression was? Really? That's your excuse? No. I could see why he confused a food intolerance test from a food allergy test because, you know, they do kind of go hand in hand in the same form of testing, in the same form of fashion, but except the testing is a little different because a food allergy test is just, it's just to see if you get into a food anaphylactic shock or if you suffer from seasonal allergies. That's something you would do the pricks with. You feel what I'm saying? But no, a food intolerance test is a little bit different. A food intolerance test is going to tell you what your gut doesn't tolerate. It's going to tell you what triggers your Hashimoto's and what makes your symptoms go under attack, okay? So that's what a food intolerance test is, and you are going to need that. You're going to need an intolerance test because you need to know why your hormones in your body is not tolerating a lot of things anymore, and I will get into that. Another thing is stress. This is what I wanted to touch base on. So stress, honey, whether if you have Hashimoto's, Graves' disease, or you're just a regular healthy person, stress is the number one killer for people, okay? And I'm going to tell you right now, take this from someone who knows that worked two jobs and went to school full time. And did not sit her ass down and get some rest, that is, okay? I don't like swearing on here because I know I could possibly get flagged, and I'm sorry, but hey, I'm not gonna sugarcoat nothing on this channel, okay? So stress is the number one cause of your low T3 and low T4 count. I'm telling you right now, if you're stressing about unnecessary stress, please let it go. It is not worth it, all right? Let it go. And if you're having normal stresses, then you need to find an outlet that's that is going to release that stress for you, no matter what it is, okay? And I'm not even gonna get into all that. Let's just get into the next thing. You should test your T3 and your free T4 every 4 to 6 weeks when starting new medication. So if you guys are starting new medication, then you need to test every 4 to 6 weeks to monitor how you're feeling and how you're doing and how your symptoms is going to be with this medication. Because like I said, medications can give you side effects, okay? And if you're not feeling well, then you need to go and get tested again and have them either up the dose or lower the dose. That's what it's for, okay? And then you need to test every 2 to 3 months if you're tracking your lifestyle change impact. So if you're making lifestyle changes to your health due to the fact that you've been diagnosed with either hypo, hyper, or Hashimoto's or Graves' disease or what have you, then you need to test every 2 to 3 months. So this way, you know, because some people don't easily take to lifestyle changes. You feel what I'm saying? Some lifestyle changes can make an even huger impact on your health, if huger is a word, that is. It will have a major impact on your life, and you don't know how it's going to impact on your health. So that's something that you need to do. You need to test every 6 to 12 months once the symptoms are stable. So this way you know exactly whether or not they're stable. So what you need to do is you need to test every 6 to 12 months once the symptoms are stable enough, okay? So this way you can keep track just in case if you're not in remission no more and your symptoms come back, then you need to go back for treatment. The next two that I will be touching base on that you do need, and this is the core of your Hashimoto's treatment, and this is going to be your breakthrough, and that is your TPO antibodies and your TG antibodies. I'm sorry if I look like I'm veering off somewhere else. It's just I'm trying to give you these gems, honey, and I'm trying to make sure that I'm giving you everything. Your TPO antibodies indicates that the thyroid gland has been recognized as a foreign invader by the immune system and that the thyroid gland is under attack. So in Hashimoto's, the triggers contribute to the body developing something called lack of tolerance. So once your TPO antibodies recognizes your thyroid as a foreign invader, or say for instance, right, you see a burglar in your house and you have a security system. Your security system is supposed to go off and alert things and then send the police over, and the police is going to come and protect you. Now, say for instance, you don't have a burglar in your house and your alarm system goes off and the police comes, but there's nobody here. And now you have police that's invading your privacy, knowing damn well there's no burglar here. And now you're in an uproar and you're trying to figure out how to get them to stop coming here and how to get your alarm system to stop going off on a false alarm. That is exactly what it is like with your TPO antibodies. It is trying to attack your thyroid that is not considered invasive to your body. It is part of your body, and you do not want your TPO antibodies to be attacking your thyroid for no reason. That's what triggers your Hashimoto's, and that's what gives you your symptoms. This is when the body is no longer able to recognize its own tissue as part of itself, but instead starts viewing its tissue as a foreign invader. It is no longer tolerant of itself, and this is what leads to an autoimmune condition. So now you guys know what TPO antibodies do when, you know, when your body's not really having a foreign invader and it's not really in danger of anything. So when the body begins this breakdown of its immune tolerance, we're initially going to see the presence of elevated thyroid antibodies. The most common antibodies in Hashimoto's are thyroid peroxidase antibodies, which is another word for TPO antibodies, and thyroid globulin antibodies, which is TG antibodies. So that is where those acronyms come from, and that's what they stand for when you do take the test. So when a doctor tells you that your TPO antibodies are high or low, or your TG antibodies are high or low, it basically stands for thyroid globulin antibodies and thyroid peroxidase. I'm sorry. I'll tell you right now. In the beginning, when they were speaking that type of language, TPO and TG, I did not know what it was. So just know you are not alone when you don't know what it is. And it's hard to pronounce these things, but trust me, honey, once you get into the swing of things, like I'm starting to get into the swing of things and I'm still learning. I don't want y'all to think I'm perfect and I know all of this, because to be honest with you, I'm still learning myself. So I don't want to give y'all that impression. These words can come off pretty difficult to pronounce. Most people with Hashimoto's will have an elevation of one or both. So it could come off either as you having TPO antibodies that are high, or TG antibodies that are high, or you can have both that are high or low, okay? So that is the purpose of you being tested for that. So the most common ones that are high, the most common antibodies that are high in most people with Hashimoto's is TPO antibodies. That is the most common that is high. So when you go get tested and they tell you, oh, your TPO antibodies are high, trust me, that is the most common in people with Hashimoto's, and that is okay. All right? You just need treatment. That's all. Thyroid antibodies are often elevated for decades before a change in TSH is seen in Hashimoto's. Before a doctor ever notices that you have Hashimoto's, your TPO antibodies are going to be high, and they're not going to understand why. They're just going to tell you, oh, it's just a form of Hashimoto's, but we can't call it just for sure yet. No, most likely it's Hashimoto's, honey, okay? Don't let them tell you that. Well, thyroid antibodies can be used for diagnostic purposes. They just use it to track it to see if your disease is in remission and if you're going to be free of symptoms or if you are free of symptoms. If you are free of symptoms like me, that means that you're in remission. If your antibodies tell you that you're not and it's back elevated again, then you need to go to your doctor to seek further treatment on what you guys can do to lower your antibody count. Since thyroid antibodies indicate an active destruction going on against your thyroid, it can come with a lot of symptoms that can be misdiagnosed by a doctor. And it can. And I'm gonna give you examples on what they are. And please tell me in the comments below if you ever been through this with doctors and they misdiagnose you with these examples. So we can be easily misdiagnosed with depression, panic attacks, anxiety, miscarriage and infertility, carpal tunnel, hair loss, weight gain, fatigue. We can also be called lazy, and trust me, I have been called lazy plenty of times and for no damn apparent reason, okay? And of course, hypochondria. And that is an insult. If you ever get a doctor, if you ever have a significant other, if you ever have family members tell you that you're just a hypochondriac and you don't know what you're talking about, honey, only you know your symptoms. Don't let nobody tell you that what you're feeling is just you being crazy. It's not. You just need to go and get these tests done so this way you know how to treat yourself. Don't listen to nobody. Honey, you got to be your own advocate for everything, okay? You cannot walk around here listening to other people telling you that there ain't nothing wrong with you because maybe they are not you. They do not feel your symptoms like you do, okay? They do not go through the stuff like you do that you go on with behind closed doors. They can't tell you who the hell you are and what you are. They can't. You get what I'm saying? You only know when the bells and whistles are going off in your body. Only you know how you feel. You get what I'm saying? Only you know how you feel. You don't want no doctor telling you that you're a hypochondriac. Uh-uh. That's an insult. That's when you need to fire a doctor. And I already told y'all in my first video, don't be afraid to fire a doctor. Because at the end of the day, this treatment is about you. This treatment is not about the doctor that you're seeing. This is not about your family members. This is not about your friends. This is not about anybody else but you. You are your own star player, and you need to have your own star player feeling good and feeling right again and feeling better, okay? So don't listen to no doctor when they tell you that you're a hypochondriac, honey, okay? You can only know you. You are your own advocate, and you are the patient, not the doctor. And don't let no doctor see you as no dollar sign, okay? Don't give them that satisfaction, all right? But here's the good news. The good news is that when you have elevated antibodies in a normal TSH, you can not only reverse your symptoms, but you could also prevent damage to your thyroid gland. It's never too late to reverse your Hashimoto's. It's not. And it's never too late to reverse your symptoms if you have Graves' disease. Even though there's no cure for this, there is a chance that you could reverse the symptoms and put yourself into remission and live an even longer, healthy life, okay? Do not say it's impossible, and don't be negative Nancy, okay? I was that. And don't get me wrong, you know, it's okay to feel sorry for yourself going through this tough time with you, but you also have to never forget that you have to get up off your butt and get yourself to that doctor and be your own advocate and be your own lawyer, honey, okay? Don't be afraid to speak up for yourself, and don't discourage yourself and don't put down yourself. Everything will be okay. You have to remember that. So here's the recommended test. And this is where everyone with Graves' disease is going to tell me, listen, girl, if you did not tell me this, I wouldn't have known nothing. Your TPO and TG should be tested, and that is for people with Hashimoto's. So if you have Hashimoto's, then you need to test your TPOs, which is your TPO antibodies, and your TG antibodies. That is the two tests that you're supposed to go for when you have Hashimoto's. Now, for people with Graves' disease, these two tests are on this list, and I put them on this list for a reason. It doesn't hurt for people with Hashimoto's to take these tests too, but these two tests are more for people with Graves' disease. For people with Graves' disease, the two tests that you should go for is your TS1 and your TB2 test. So I don't know exactly what a TF1 is and a TB2 is for people with Graves' disease, but I will put the article that I got this information from down below, so this way you guys can read more about the TF1 and the TB2 test. So this way, for those with Graves' disease, you guys can figure out what those tests are and how you need to get them. So this is how often you should test for it. So you should monitor your thyroid antibodies every 60 to 90 days to see if the changes you're making in your lifestyle are helping you. So any lifestyle changes you make, you need to take these tests every 60 to 90 days. So this way you know whether if your symptoms are starting to decrease or your symptoms are getting worse, then you need to see your doctor again and get tested again to see if there's further treatment and to see if your lifestyle changes are working for you. If those symptoms are not going away and those antibodies are still elevated, that means the lifestyle changes are working and you need to change your game up. A reduction in these antibodies as well as symptoms indicate that your condition is improving. So once you start seeing your antibodies decreasing, the number of antibodies decreasing in your immune system, that means that you are getting better. That means that you are well on your way and you need to keep doing what you're doing, okay? That means you're doing a very good job and you're on your way to being in remission. And that is where you get your sexy back, okay? That's where you will feel good again and you'll feel like yourself again. Another thing everyone needs to know, and this is the number one I automatically tell you that is a must for a test. The main thing that is on this list that you need to have is your thyroid ultrasound. You need at least one thyroid ultrasound for people who have Hashimoto's. You need at least one. So this way, if your blood tests are not telling you anything, then you need to have a thyroid ultrasound so this way you can see the physical effects of it. So now I'm gonna give you the informational version, okay? Your thyroid ultrasound can be used to find physical changes in the thyroid gland that point to Hashimoto's. It will help you and your doctor determine whether you have changes consistent with your Hashimoto's, like rubbery thyroid, shrunken thyroid, enlarged thyroid like I had, or an abnormal growth. Some growths may indicate an autoimmune process, others may indicate benign nodules, and others may signal cancerous nodules. So that is what this thyroid ultrasound can be used for. It can save your life, okay? If you have cancerous nodules, but your blood tests aren't coming up, and it's just saying it's normal, but then you go for the thyroid ultrasound, and you see that there's cancerous nodules, honey, you just saved your own life. Okay, what if you were to walk out with normal levels and you didn't do your thyroid ultrasound and then you find out later that you have cancer and you didn't know? Okay, that thyroid ultrasound is going to save your life. That is exactly why you need a thyroid ultrasound. So like I said before, everyone with Hashimoto's should have at least one ultrasound done. Your ultrasound needs a doctor's order. So just know, you can ask your doctor for a thyroid ultrasound, but it's not just going to be immediate. You know, your doctor has to order one. Your doctor has to put in the request for the ultrasound in order for you to get one. So just know that, okay? This is how often you should have a thyroid ultrasound. You need at least one ultrasound for every person, especially women of childbearing age. Around 10% of those with Hashimoto's were diagnosed by an ultrasound. Anyone who is childbearing and that has children definitely needs an ultrasound, and here's why. Because your thyroid hormones also helps your baby, okay? And this is why when you have thyroid problems, we are prone to miscarriages. You're also prone to infertility because your thyroid hormone is what also plays a part in you having a child. You know what I'm saying? Your child benefits from those hormones. And if you're not getting enough of those hormones or those hormones are too high, your baby will be put at risk. So this is why thyroid ultrasound is so important for people who are having children. Another reason why it's important is because not all of us with Hashimoto's are going to see any results with our blood tests. Sometimes our blood tests could come back normal and we'll still suffer from symptoms and things will still happen. So that is why people that most likely take the blood test and have normal levels will most likely find out that, you know, they have Hashimoto's based on a thyroid ultrasound. Because your doctor may see things in your thyroid ultrasound that they didn't pick up on before. So that's how beneficial it is. Another test that you need is your reverse T3 test. Your reverse T3 test actually measures how much of the reactive T3 is able to bind at thyroid receptors, okay? So your RT3 is produced in stressful situations and binds to thyroid receptors, but turns them off instead of activating them. So it is very important to get your reverse T3 done. I'm still trying to learn about reverse T3, so I did write a couple facts on my index card, so this way you guys are not confused as well as I am, and I don't want to ever misinform my viewers. So this is why I wrote some of this stuff down, and I don't ever want to misinform you guys about anything. This is really important and it's part of your health. Your RT3 test is sometimes used to identify cases of poor T4 to T3 conversion, just like we talked about earlier. You know, you want to make sure that your T3 and your T4s are not inhibited, and this is why a RT3 test is going to tell if it's being interfered with or inhibited with, or whether or not they are poor. Okay, it also tracks your thyroid symptoms that are due to adrenal stress instead of thyroid malfunction or autoimmunity. Now, I will touch base on a bonus test, and I'm going to give that to you right now because it is going to play into this. Usually when people test a reverse T3 test, most of the time, I will say that reverse T3 is sometimes not effective. You don't get enough answers in your reverse T3, here is another test that is going to help you. And I have took this test and I have to retake this test again because for some reason, the test didn't really give accurate results. Another test that is highly recommended above the reverse T3. So if you guys don't prefer to take your reverse T3 and your reverse T3 doesn't tell you anything about how stress is affecting your thyroid, another thing that can tell you if it's affecting your thyroid is the adrenal saliva test. Honey, when I tell you, that test is going to determine everything for you, okay? Whether if you could tolerate exercising or not. The adrenal saliva test is going to give you a guidance on whether or not if you could take cardio exercises, if you need more of a on the soft side type of exercise like yoga or weightlifting. Those type of things, it is also going to tell you how you handle stress, okay? That is very effective, and it's also going to tell you the reason why you are consistently tired and why you have so much fatigue, okay? So just know that adrenal saliva test, ooh baby, that is a gem right there, and that is going to be your bonus, all right? So if you don't get a reverse T3 from your doctor, request a adrenal saliva test. If they tell you no, go to somebody else, okay? And most likely you are going to get your adrenal saliva test done by an alternative doctor. If you can't do that, go to a testing center. There is a testing center that will do it, and I will definitely put the testing center down below, the lab that you can go to down below. I went to this lab, and oh my gosh, what state of the art, honey, I love it. All right, they give you everything you need. So I will put down the lab down below in the description box. So this way you guys know what labs to take. And you can look for those tests as well. If you don't have access to those tests and you don't have a certain type of insurance to see an alternative doctor, honey, you could easily go for that test and go to a diagnostic center. Okay, so adrenal saliva test helps determine the proper treatment for adrenal stress. Another thing is that an adrenal saliva test gives us the advantage of knowing how to address. The reason one is producing too much reverse T3. That's exactly what the adrenal test is. And like I said, I'm gonna put down in the description box below where you can go get tested for that if you guys don't have access to an alternative doctor. So I will give that. Here's how often you should take the test. So the reverse T3 test, you should take every 6 months if recommended by your integrative doctor, okay? So integrative doctors are the ones that do your reverse T3. So if a regular doctor won't do it for you, just know that you can go to an alternative doctor to get it done, okay? It's not the end of the world because some doctors don't get paid to do extensive testing. Sometimes you may be told an excuse that they don't do that testing there and they can't, or they will tell you, give you an excuse of, oh, you don't need that, it's okay, and they may brush it off, okay? Don't let them do that. Make sure to go to another doctor and have them do that reverse T3. I think you should personally go to an alternative doctor, and here's why. Because my alternative doctor is the reason why I have gotten my reverse T3 done. That's most likely who you're gonna get it from. Your symptoms for the reverse T3, it should serve as an important thyroid test. Listen to your body. Only you know. Only you know your symptoms. No one else does. Not your family, not your friends. okay? You know. This is your body. You know about this, okay? You know you. No one knows you better than you, okay? You are that queen or that king that knows your body better than anyone else. And don't let no doctor brush you off and tell you that it's not gonna work, because it is, okay? Don't do that. Other symptoms than the most common associated with hypo or hyperthyroid, I'm gonna tell you right now, is anxiety, depression, mood swings, your gastrointestinal issues. So just know that if you have acid reflux really bad to the point where you're vomiting, like I have, or if you are suffering from GERD or any type of gastrointestinal problems, you need these tests, because it will be most likely that you are hypo or hyperthyroid, okay? Never ever think that it is far-fetched to get these tests, because some people just walk around not knowing that they're hypo or hyper and think that it's just minor, all right? Another set of symptoms that will tell you that is if you're constantly fatigued, if you have brain fog, cold hands, cold feet. Honey, trust me, I have cold feet all the time, all right? So just know that. And food sensitivities, like I told you before, food sensitivities, that's hypo or hyper, all right? Recommended test is to create a timeline based on your symptoms alone, okay? Only you know what your symptoms are, all right? Your symptoms are going to be the final test, all right? Your symptoms is the final test for you. And here's why, because like I said, only you know you, all right? And no one is gonna know you like you know you. And you're not a hypochondriac for thinking that there's something wrong with you and you know there's something wrong with you. Only your intuition can tell you. You have to follow your intuition and you have to follow your own gut. You have to advocate for yourself and you cannot let no doctor talk you down. Don't get discouraged when a doctor talks you down and makes it seem like as if you're crazy. Honey, no. Keep going for a second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. I don't even give a damn if it's 100 doctors you go through. Honey, do it. You are your own advocate. I've watched my mom do it. My mom went to 6 doctors before she found out she had thyroid cancer, okay? I've been to 11 doctors before I found out that I had Hashimoto's. Honey, listen, only you know you. You are a king or a queen, and only you know you, and you need to go do that. Make sure you create a timeline and use a notebook or chart to keep track of your symptoms and score the severity of your symptoms from 1 to 10. And how often you should test your symptoms? Assess your symptoms on a weekly basis until you feel you have eliminated them, all right? That is it for this video. Those are the top 10 tests. And I want you guys to advocate for yourself and be your best advocate when you go in there, all right? I want you to like, share, and subscribe to this channel. And follow me on Instagram at LadyDream890, all right? I love you guys. And you guys need to join the Lady Dream team. I don't know what's up with y'all watching my videos and not subscribing, honey. But all I know is that if you don't subscribe, baby, you are missing all these gems, okay? You want to get your sexy back, right? This is the way to do it. This is the way to go. So subscribe, honey, okay? Like, share, and subscribe to this channel. And I want you to stay clean, stay safe, wash your hands, and don't be nasty. And wear your mask everywhere you go, okay? I know I'm sick of COVID, you're sick of COVID, trust me, honey, I am, okay? I'm tired, but I have to wear my mask. I am too sexy of a queen to be laying up in somebody's hospital sick, and you guys are too sexy of kings and queens to be laying up in somebody's hospital sick too, all right? So I wish you nothing but love, peace, and positivity. I love you guys. Talk to you guys soon, all right? And make sure you hit that notification bell to know when your girl is available with new videos, all right? Love you guys. Namaste. Bye.